Yetzias Mitzrayim is the penultimate event in human history.
Joined with my good and trusted friend, Rafi Farbar. We're reporting to you from the Golan Heights.
Good evening.
Good evening, people of the world. Gentlemen and ladies, remember your genders. The world is becoming a very interesting place. Anyway, we have a lot of Indiana to talk about today. Rafi, how's your week going? Is that all good?
My week has been very nice, thank God. How's yours?
Well, yeah, you know, hustling, doing the grind.
That was my first impression of you, hustler.
Yeah, I mean, I like to do a lot of things that, I like to do a lot of small things and start building them slowly, especially things that I think, you know, like vending machines, you know, selling online, all these stuff that don't really take up too much time. You can do a lot of them at the same time. Because once you lock yourself down with a 9-to-5 job, that's it. You only have one, all your time is swallowed.
Are there any 9-to-5 jobs in Katrin besides the winery? There's no 9-to-5ers here.
No, but there are some.
Some.
There's olive oil, there's there's hotels near the area that need maintenance and whatever. There's all kinds of jobs. I mean, you know. It's just some people, I think they're like Yisachar, you know, like the donkey that just needs hard work. And the hard work is what keeps them at bay to their own inner wild animals.
Yisachar was born this week.
Yeah, you could say it's a genetic concept. Or, you know, I mean, there's the Yisachar in every current community, if you know what I mean. I think it's a mentality of a person that I think, you know, he doesn't want to deal with himself. He's too scared to look inside. So he just distracts himself with a bunch of hard work.
That's what most people do.
Which is sad, no? People should be content with themselves.
You mean the tribal Yisachar? I mean Yisachar Ben Yaakov, the tribe?
Yeah. He works like a donkey, like a donkey that if you don't tell him to stop working, he's just going to work himself to death. Mm-hmm. Because he's so hell-bent, he feels that his work, like a workaholic we call today, the work is his savior or something. And he makes a deal with his brother Zvulun, or is that?
Yeah, Yisachar Zvulun relationship, yeah.
Yeah, he makes a deal that they're going to learn, and he's going to give half his money to the one who's learning. In other words, and you can say learning, but it could also mean like his philosopher, his mental stability, like his therapist. He's going to give half his money to his therapist to sort out his life. Basically, I'm working so hard, I don't have time to actually think about what I need to do or what's important, to research things. So I'm going to give half my money to this other guy to basically deal with all the technical stuff mentally, because that's too much for me.
Right. Well, you can only do that so far. At some point, you have to face your own reality, your own problems. I mean, you can outsource it for a while you work and try to, you know, get your head together, get your life together, pay someone.
But
to
you know that Adam Karavitz a lot of money, so maybe it's better that you have somebody else telling you.
Well, yeah, you should. I mean, it's hard to look at yourself and be honest with yourself. So sometimes most of the time, you do need someone else looking in. A fresh pair of eyes, fresh set of eyes. You know, sometimes it can't even be your family because they're
also involved in the events. Right?
Your patterns kind of get similar, and you behave in certain ways and start to act like each other and become sort of like a one unit, which is, you know, it's good in one way, but it also blinds all of you in another way. So.
Yeah, that's why I recommend a family therapy 1 hour a week for people that are married, especially if you come from homes which were a little dysfunctional. That's just my humble opinion.
Well, especially today, when even the poorest, maybe not the poorest of the poor, but even the poorest people generally are not starving to death, and they don't have to worry about basic survival needs. Maybe they're stressed with debt and this, but they know even if they declare bankruptcy, they're still going to have food the next day. They'll eat. But the point is that...
Maybe it's time that we should upgrade our lives. Is that what you're saying?
No. The point is that you know, even 100, 200 years ago, people had to fear for their survival, and that's what kept them going. That's what kept, you know, family matters and problems at bay, because who has time to think about your psychological health when you're trying to figure out how to survive? And, you know, the struggle to survive kept, you know, psychological problems in the background or not even relevant, because you don't have time for that. So people, paradoxically, might have been happier because they weren't worried about their own, you know, self-actualization problems, which we're all worried about now, because we all have food to eat. We conquered the world. We're done. And now we have all these other problems. But,
you know, that actually is like what happened in China, which is that you had, first, there was actual starvation issues in China, and then everyone moved to the cities, and they worked for pennies on the dollar, you know, for hours and hours and hours in all the factories, and then all the jobs went to China. And then, now, this generation of Chinese are not starving anymore, they're not as desperate as they used to be, and they want good things for their life, and they're asking for more money. And now what's happening is, you see a lot more cheap labor going to other countries, like North Koreans and all kinds of other... I don't know if...
Who outsources to North Korea? That would be a good move.
Yeah.
You know, North Koreans are probably the last country in the world that's really starving.
Yeah, so you go to... So what's happening now is you have all these... Even in Qatar, you have a... Filipino.
Yeah, those aren't North Koreans.
Right, they're not North Koreans, right, but... Saying you have the Philippines and you have all these other weaker countries that are now getting China's old jobs for that old low money income, and now China is now doing the more detailed, more experience, you know, the jobs that you need more experience with, you know, like not just this, like a glass with a straw stuck in that's probably, I don't know, made in some shithole, as Trump would say. Yeah, but you have the more complex thing, maybe the phones, the machinery, like the more hard, you know, harder to make in a simple country that they don't have, they're not that advanced yet. So then you still need, and China still needs a little bit. But right now there's the exodus from the big cities. Everyone's leaving the big cities in China and also in New York, but for other reasons completely. So to back to your point, where most people aren't starving for food, and the ones that are getting cheap labor jobs. So, yeah, I mean, now is time to upgrade our lives. So back in the day, people are like, well, what are all these narcissists and psychopaths, all this talk about all these different symptoms and, you know, psychological traumas and this and that. It's all becoming a thing now. People are talking about their identity. And then you have, like, the other extreme, teenagers, which are these spoiled pizza pie brats leaking from trans fat in their mother's basement. They don't even know what the real world is. But that's a different topic.
Reminds me of a pasuk in Hazinu, right? Shamanta Vita Kasita.
What is that?
Was it Vaishman Yeshurun Vaiv At Shamanta Vita Kasita, and Yeshurun, which is a word for Israel, got fat.
He got fat, and then he started kicking. In other words, rebelling.
And now he's like spoiled. Really spoiled and fat, like, you know, moving around like a fat American. And interesting.
Avram Avinu, when he saw the people of Canaan, he said, "I want my people," because he saw them working hard and hustling. He said, "I want my kids to be here." And when he passed by other places, he saw them just sitting around eating a hamburger or something. He just saw them lazy, not doing anything. He said, "Oh, I don't want my kids to have a part in this."
Well, he didn't want his son marrying any Canaanite woman.
Canines.
Yeah. So my wife was telling me, she was having a conversation with a coworker, and a Christian Arab from not Sarat, I think, something like that. And she was trying to explain to my wife what Christmas was. She didn't, like, she forgot that, you know, we grew up in Miami. We know what Christmas is, you know. We're very exposed to Christmas. We're Americans. We don't know what that is. So then she's like, well, where are you from? Well, Miami. Why did you leave to come here?
Everyone asks me that. And I don't know if it's because they're stupid or because... Because
they don't see what's happening. They only see the consumption, but they don't see that the entire society is in the process, the fast process of a complete collapse.
The police in the States are extremely brutal, in my humble opinion. Even in the rural areas, which is surprising. They're very on the law. They'll give a ticket to you. The law is God in the States. And
you too. Shilton HaChuk is the saying here.
Yeah, but the police here are just a tad. And also, they give a little more, a tiny drop of space. And also, it's like Sean Lee told me in China, for example. The police come to a house for a call, and 10 minutes later, they're sitting with the owner on a cup of tea or something, schmoozing the issue, and then they just leave. They don't get. Then he told me they don't get paid a lot. They get like minimum wage to be a cop or something. So they don't feel any. And also, they're like, "Oh, I'm just here, whatever." They told me to come here. They don't have any. It's more emotional. The whole connection is emotional.
Right.
It's all in America. It's just law, brick in the wall, like. Americans don't understand what's happening in Hong Kong right now. They don't know what the
I don't think anyone understands what's happening.
So let me enlighten you, Sean.
You understand what's happening in Hong Kong?
Rafi, let me tell you. There's a couple laws, and China's breaking those laws. British made an agreement, blah, 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 blah. Everything's written over there. And China, the big government, is just like, whatever. Whatever. So what if there's laws? We use them sometimes, we lose them sometimes. And, you know, they take the whole concept of laws are meant to be broken. So the Americans don't understand what's happening because Americans, for them, a law is like, I don't see you understand. Like, you can understand it technically. But they don't understand which person in their right mind would just blatantly even have the idea to go against a law, especially if they're coming from a government. Like, it's not something, but Jews can understand because Jews, I think, are... We have kind of like this, we have a little bit of both, you know? We know that the law is the law is the law, but at the same time, we also are human enough or emotional enough to understand people, you know, from where they're coming from, why, where, what. We've traveled the world. We've seen that sometimes this, sometimes that. We have it in our, not just we as this guy, that Jew, this. In general, we have it in our DNA to understand a different way, you know, that's why Jews are successful, I think, in every place they go.
I don't know if it has anything to do with genes more than we have a shared culture and history that Americans don't have. America, you know, the melting pot, everyone comes from a different culture. So immediately when a cop comes to your house, you don't know what his cultural history is, anything. Like, it's a threat, so you become formal, and like the relationship becomes law versus citizen. Whereas here, like, a cop comes to your house, it's another Jew. Like, I know where he comes from. I know his basic history. Like, okay, so, like, just like you can get into terrible fights with your family, like, really, like, scream at each other and say horrible things, you know, but at the same time, it's your family who can, you know, make up with you pretty quickly and you know, have a real conversation. So, I mean, there's family ties here, for good and bad. It makes fights extreme, and it makes things a little bit less formal between the law and the citizenry, which is it's a good thing. It makes it less scary.
Yeah, you know, like the famous, you know that story with the guy that had his horses stuck in the mud, and he had very, very expensive horses, and the guy with a couple little ponies came and pulled him out of the mud. You know the story?
I know.
Okay, so there's a guy. That's basically the story. But he asks him. He asks him, how can you pull? You have these little ponies. He said they're all brothers. What you did was you got four horses over there. One's this huge, you know, the best German horse. The other one's the best Russian horse. And the other one's the best Swedish horse.
So they're all trying to do the job themselves.
And the other one's the best Ukrainian horse. There's no unit. There's no unity. Each one's basically flexing. Each one wants to be the one. And each one's working in a different mentality. My ponies, maybe they're four little ponies, but They're all brothers. They work the same way. They're not in a competition. They're working as a team. I think that whether a guy is hiring workers or whatever he's doing, if you have a group of people and they're similar, it just makes things much better. And that's why I think like private schools in general are much more successful, because in public schools you just, it's like, imagine your class is like one Indian, one Arab, one Jew, one this, one that, and you can only unite them on like a very limited amount of things. Like their culture is very, you can't even get into their head in the same place. You know what I mean? Each person, something else is what makes them tick, and it's just.
Well, I mean, when you have schools operating on the free market, then they will tend to attract similar types of students. You know, if you have a
free, give the best experience to those specific.
You have a free market school. You have you can have a school for kids interested in this.
You have a Christian school. You have a Muslim school, Jewish school. We have the best Jewish learning, and we have the best Muslim learning. We have the best Christian learning. Give the best Hindu learning. You want to know how many hands the God of India has? Well, we can figure it out for you.
Doesn't have to be that. If you have like a school for like kids that show interest in building and engineering when they're like 6 or 7 years old, you can have a school for that. I mean, you don't have to have these core curriculums where everyone has to.
Yeah, you can divide it. It doesn't have to be divided by religion, right?
And how the government elects itself and all the history of all the Russia and Mimshallah and all the government, like most of the stuff that they teach in school is like how to respect the government and the history of the country and the history of what the government did and all the wars that it fought, all this meaningless, nonsensical history. It doesn't matter. Who cares?
I think it matters, but not to us.
It matters
to the government. Trivial. The government needs you to think that wars are acceptable. Like Julian Assange, I just saw the video recently of him saying, in the last 50 years, all the wars and all the blood that was spilled could have been prevented and was pushed by the media. In other words, if the media would have done its due diligence and get to the bottom of 9/11, for example, or for other things, then huge wars and tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of lives could have been saved. And the media, there are some brilliant journalists. You have Project Veritas. You have a Cog.
Yeah, but they're always prosecuted. They're always persecuted.
They're chased around.
The real journalist, like Assange, he was a real journalist.
And
at the actual things that they're trying to hide, and he's lost his life. He's gonna die, and that's what I fear.
I hope he's not gonna die. I hope the brewing revolution. I mean, obviously, he could die, but I hope that the brewing revolution will save him in time, basically. Because the world is changing. I used to think that it's the right, everyone's voting right, but then I realized that it's not just about that. It's about the whole government. I mean, it used to be that the monarchs and the people that run the show, they just got there because they ripped everyone's heads off that they didn't like, or that they were just very brutal people. Like you have the Moshiach.
It's the same thing now, except that the brutality happens behind closed doors and the media doesn't report on it.
So that's what's happening now. Now the citizens are uniting and they're sharing information and they're just screwing the whole thing up and they're just busting as much as they can, obviously, which is very limited, because the internet at the end of the day is not a power. It's not weapons and ideologies.
It's just information.
It's just information, and ideologies are uniting, but still, like, what does it help you if you have a million people that want freedom but they're spread out all over the world and they can't even get together? I mean, there's but everyone, and that's what's happening now. You have a lot of people that are working hard for freedom and for the truth and justice and to end corruption and all that.
Well, that's why I'm waiting for the bankruptcy and the fall of the dollar. Once they run out of resources, then all the regulations and all the restrictions that they put on us, they kind of.
But the Federal Reserve and these things, they could just add zeros. You think it's gonna be hard to press on the keyboard like at this point?
Adding once you get to a point where people believe that inflation will keep getting worse, then it doesn't matter how many zeros you add, it's over. Because people don't want to use the money anymore at all.
So you're saying it's all about people wanting to use the money. That's when it ends.
It's people thinking that they can still use the money, that it will still buy things. Once they realize that it won't buy things anymore, then it's over. I mean, the government has no more finances. They can't do anything. Well, they can try to restart and rebuild, but they
do you think like when you went to the store today, did you use money?
Yeah, I used money. I because that's the unit of account now. But, I mean, I think
the reserves. The telltale signs of what you're saying, I think, will be when people start to broker deals with something else other than money.
It will always be money. It just depends what the money is.
Right. No, I'm saying other than the currencies of the government. Like, I don't see, like, there are some countries that did the Bitcoin thing, right?
They have it in all the stores. Not really.
There's one place I heard of
that. I think Japan technically made it legal tender, but I don't even know what that means. Because legal tender means you can pay taxes in that currency. I don't see anyone paying taxes in Bitcoin in Japan. So.
Right, but no, I'm saying there's like a place where they did, like, all the coffee shops and all the stores in that whole area take Bitcoin.
Where?
Check it online.
I don't even see how taking Bitcoin is economic at all. Because
it's too fragile. It's too jumpy.
It's all over the place. It's not stable. Like, somebody gives you a tenth of a Bitcoin for whatever, and then tomorrow it's worth half that amount.
Yeah, it's like, how much is a coffee? 50 cents. 50 cents? 50 Bitcoin cents. And the value goes up and down. But that's the thing. If people just move all their money into Bitcoin, and it doesn't matter anymore because the prices are set in Bitcoin. And let the dollar chase the Bitcoin.
Nobody can have a business where the prices are set in Bitcoin. There'd be no way that it would be viable. Not now.
Oh, because you'd be losing money because the thing is moving too fast.
It moves all over the place. You'd never be able to.
It would be a gamble.
Business has to be predictable. You have to. If a currency inflates 2% a year, 3% a year, even 10% a year. You can hedge against that. You can calculate for it in the future, and therefore you can make business calculations. But you can't calculate when the currency moves like $1,000 in an hour and then back down $2,000 the next hour. It's impossible.
Right. Okay. So you think that a stable currency that's not connected to government. Because people are going to – no one's going to start – I don't see a day when people are going to start carrying loaves of bread and chickens and onions.
We're not going back to barter. That's not what's happening.
So what's happening? What do you think – you think gold and silver?
And that's what it's been for thousands of years. I mean, that's what the Torah used. I mean, the Torah's standard is – the halakha standard is the silver standard. Gold is considered tuvin.
No, do you think, but gold and silver also is a little jumpy, or is it's stable, stable as a dollar?
It's much more stable than Bitcoin. And it depends how you look at it. Is it the dollar that's losing power, or is it gold that's gaining it? I mean, it depends how you want to look at it. But I mean, gold is pretty stable. It doesn't move $1,000 in a day.
But how much, let's say, is for a coin of gold this big? It's about $1,000, did you know?
What, an ounce? An ounce goes for $1,480, I think, today.
But that's too much to trade, is it? You want to go to the store and I want to... Okay, silver. A coin this big of silver.
So that's about, you know, $16, $17. It's normal money.
Okay, and copper, like a... you see, that's what I'm saying.
Copper's like $2 a pound, something like that.
$2 a pound? You see, that's too big. Nickel. I'm trying everything. Aluminium? What are we going to do?
Retail money is silver.
I need a dollar coin. Can I get a dollar coin? That's not because of a state and not because its value is a dollar. Maybe they on purpose made that there shouldn't be any. No, we have to find the metal.
What do you mean a dollar coin? A dollar coin where the physical coin itself.
The physical coin is worth a freaking dollar.
Or is it a token that's worth like a cent that says dollar on it?
That's what I'm saying. I need the weight or the value of a dollar in a coin, and I need a half a 50 cents. I need 50 cents, dollar.
What dollar? A 1913 dollar or 2009?
No, just like you told me, a silver coin is $17. So that's like, let's say that's a 20, okay? Let's say it's a 20. So I can go to the store and say, here, 20 silver.
Okay, so then back when the dollar was on,
so you may, oh maybe
back
if I
when
make
the
like
dollar
a,
was on a silver standard, right? You'd have a silver dollar weighs whatever ounces.
Okay, at that time, a dollar was worth a coin of silver.
Yeah, but if you take a silver dime, like a real silver dime from like 1936, you know those mercury dimes, that should be a tenth of the weight of a dollar because it was silver by weight. So a silver dime is worth about $1.70, something like that.
Oh, that's cool. So like the shekel coin or the dime that we have.
The dime is
an American dime. That
a silver American dime from 1964.
Okay, but for our purposes, even if it's just the size and weight of a dime, doesn't have to have any stamp. It's worth a dollar. Boom!
About
boom!
A little more,
like $1.50. See, that's what things get complicated. Or no, I mean, if we move to that currency, then maybe.
No, but still, I don't even think that people are going to be like, you know, getting their coins from their purses and you know, counting out dimes to buy something at a store.
Why not?
Because
you go to a store, you're not looking to make a huge shopping. You just want to, you know, what you want to buy a Coke from.
No, people are gonna store gold and silver on their phones or whatever. Maybe it's gonna be a gold or silver backed cryptocurrency or something, and they'll transfer those credits. And then
do you think
companies that make credits and that have either good reputations or bad reputations for backing them with real assets or not. And you know, it'll
oh,
be
so
a,
you're going
it'll be
you're,
a free
you're
market
saying that
and
people
money.
People will go and have to. Bring their gold and silver to a guy.
They wouldn't even have to bring it. They'll already have it stored. I mean, I have a service like that called Gold Money that I use.
So Gold Money basically is like it's like PayPal but just in gold.
Yeah, it's PayPal and gold. Yeah, you can pay people in gold. You can that have their accounts in gold or you know gold backed cryptocurrencies are a good idea. I mean, as long as there's something stable.
Gold backed cryptocurrency. Tell me more.
No, gold-backed cryptocurrency. It's pretty simple. I mean, how Bitcoin works, but Bitcoin doesn't really have anything behind it that people can say, "Ah, that is a Bitcoin." It's just it's a code.
So gold-backed cryptocurrency is
that would work, I think.
Does that exist?
Yeah, it does exist. Yeah.
And how's that doing?
I don't know. I don't have any. I think it's called Digix Gold or something like that.
I think that in order for this to happen, the faith in the shekel in Israel or the dollar in America or whatever currency, the governments need to collapse.
It's all based on the dollar. That's going to happen soon. I mean, I know what the fuse is. Did I talk about this before?
You spoke about it, but I don't know if we went – I feel that I don't understand it 100%. Maybe there's some information we're missing.
Well, look. Here's the steps. Whenever the business cycle expands in tandem, everything expands at the same time, right? All the money is printed, and then banks expand, and they lend more money, and then those businesses expand, and then you have a whole slew of economic boom everywhere, and everyone's rich, right? But then it all collapses at the same time too. So the next banking crisis, when the next big bank falls, it's going to bring all of them down with it. And however much money they had to print back then, they're going to have to print like five or six times as much this time. And that'll be it. There's going to be no faith in government currencies after that. But the bank to fall.
You think the world is going to look like Venezuela? The currency is just going to be floating in the streets? Nobody's going to care?
No, I don't think the world is going to look like Venezuela. I hope not. I mean, I hope not here. Maybe parts of it will. But I don't know what's going to happen. It's going to be bad.
What? One second. This is something like there's a guy named David Icke. I don't know if you've heard of him. He works with Alex Jones and his crew over there. Mm-hmm. David Knight, whatever. David, I don't know. I think his last name is Icke, but he calls him. Anyway, the point is, he says that there's this every 70 years. Like or every 70 years or every 80 years or every 100 years, I'm not sure. He has a certain calculation that there's a big change in the world, and Donald Trump lands like smack on that moment.
Oh, whatever, all these like mystical calculations.
No, not mystical. Actually, it's very technical. It's very technical. He points out the technical things that happened. It's just like you're looking at a tree, but it grows too slowly for you to see the change. But if you know someone that actually saw,
Look, I can pin it down much more specifically. I can't give you an exact year, but I can tell you when, around what time of the year it'll happen, and which bank is going to be the first one, and then what's going to happen.
I heard that Deutsche Bank is suffering.
Yeah, Deutsche Bank is going to be the one. In 1931, it was Credit Anstalt, it's an Austrian bank called Credit Anstalt that collapsed, that precipitated the rest of the Depression.
What's happening in Deutsche Bank?
Interestingly, Credit Anstalt was wrapped up into what is now Deutsche Bank. It's the same bank.
And what's the deal with that? What's this Deutsche Bank about?
Deutsche Bank had these ambitions to become a huge international bank when it was just mostly a German bank. But around like 2007, 2008, they decided to expand. It's a bad time. So they can't make money anymore. They've had to downsize. But still, they're systemically connected to every other bank. When they fall, that's the domino. If you look at their stock price, it's like a fuse.
The connection between, let's give an example, Bank of America and Deutsche Bank. What's their connection? Assuming that a typical Deutsche Bank and another Bank of America, for example, connection.
Well, they all own government bonds. They have a lot of derivatives on their balance. Derivatives are pieces of paper that derive their value from some other piece of paper, which derives its value from some other piece of paper, which is all based on money that is supposedly owed them that will be paid back. Like, for example, like a bond, like a U.S. government bond, a treasury bond. It has value on a balance sheet. So if the bank has that bond, this piece of paper, it's a promise for the U.S. to pay on its balance sheet, they say, oh, the business is worth X amount of money because we have this amount of paper that is worth this much. But everyone's balance sheet, all the banks are loaded up with the debt of somebody else promising to pay. So whenever this whole domino thing falls and like one can't
nobody's
pay,
paying for bonds. People are just trading them once in a while. No.
Yeah, but primary.
Dealers, like Bank of America, let's say, has how much does Bank of America have of American bonds, of a U.S. government bond?
How much do they hold? I'd have to look at their balance sheet. I don't know.
Well, throw a vague assumption. I don't know. Just for the sake of our conversation, so we can carry on.
I don't know. Let's say they own $50 billion in bonds. I'm sure it's more than that.
Okay, so let's say for the sake of the conversation, they have $50 billion American government bonds, which basically are tied to the quote unquote value of America, right? The value of the American government. So,
well, the ability of the American government to tax value.
Oh, okay. So is the American government buying its bonds back from banks?
The American government does not buy bonds back. They pay out the interest, and then the Fed buys the bonds. I mean, they print. It's a never ending cycle. The government can never pay off its bonds because it's always borrowing more. So like it needs the Fed to buy the bonds, to print the money to buy the bonds, so they can keep borrowing. I mean, that's how the cycle keeps going.
Yes, it's a real mess.
There's no end to it until it collapses. It can't. A lot of libertarians.
Who
like
who,
to point
who
out,
wins? Who wins while this is happening?
Who wins? The people that get to use the money first. I mean, when the Fed prints the money, when they print money into existence, then the people that use before that money is used by anybody, it doesn't exist in the money supply. But once somebody transacts with it and buys something with it, from that point it enters. It enters circulation.
So you're saying basically, let's say a guy in the Federal Reserve decides, you know what, I'm going to print me myself some $2 million and take them away and
It's not the Fed. It's not the people on the Fed that benefit. It's the politicians in the government that want to spend money and buy votes and stay in power. They're the ones who benefit because they decide ultimately what they spend it on. The first people to spend new money are always the ones that win. The last people to spend the new money, like the salary earners, like you and me. We're the ones that have to suffer inflation, which is why they always say, "Oh, there has to be more inflation, and we can't sustain the economy without inflation." Like they can't because they benefit from it, whereas salary earners who get a flat salary every month or whatever
work
it is
hard work and yeah. actually make create the value of the money yeah. before it they're the ones who actually create the value. It's almost like mitzvahs, you know? It's like, because like if you look at Hasidus, it's like the whole, all the worlds, the Elamis Al-Yonim, they call it, right? The higher worlds. Everything is all for the Jew doing the mitzvah. It all the value, the dira b'tachlenim, it all boils down to what's happening down here. Everything was all created just in order to get this specific result. That's almost like the same thing with the money. It's like at the end of the day, that's why I always tell my friends, never work for a job that you wouldn't do anyway for free. Because at the end of the day, what you do is what you do. That's what you're doing. That's what you're contributing to the world. Like,
lots of people, they get a lot of satisfaction out of the stuff that they do for free, whatever it's chesed or it's tzedakah or anything. They don't get paid, and there's work that you can do that isn't valued economically, that has a value to it, that can give you meaning. And you know,
of course, but I'm saying other than that, even the work that you are doing and you're getting paid for, I think it should be work that you would be happy doing anyway. Like my nature
it should be, but not everyone can do that.
Yeah, not everyone can afford to, but I think it's a good goal. Like, if you're a nice guy and you like giving people food and preparing them food and you feel satisfied when you see 20, 30, 40, 50 customers eating whatever, their lunch, so then maybe you should try to get into that. Or if you're a kind of person that, I don't know, you get satisfied by helping people in a certain way, then try to make that your job should be connected to that, and then whatever, work at it. You'll also enjoy your job. You'll also have the passion. You won't get like work fatigue or whatever, because you'll actually be happy for the other person at the end of the day.
Well, even if you love your job, and at some point you will get work fatigue where you have to...
You have to push yourself.
You have to reframe your mind. I mean, I was actually talking to one of my Chabad friends, Chabad of Brandeis, where I went to college.
Okay.
And, he's the Chabad house there. I lived there as a senior. But he came when I was a freshman, and he came to Israel a few years ago, and he was telling me, like, he's been there for like what 15-16 years now, and like, you know, at some point, like, he and his wife, they just broke. They just like had a nervous breakdown about like having a Chabad, and they love it. Of course they love it. They're really into it, and they have all these Shabbat meals, and they're growing, and it's exciting, and spreading Judaism and Chozer Mitzvah and all this other stuff. But like at some point, it drives you crazy doing the same thing every week. And like,
so they left?
No, they didn't leave. They kind of like they had a breakdown, and then they kind of like reshuffled their minds, and you know, found a new motivation for whatever they were doing, and then kept going. I mean, like, everyone has breakdowns.
Yeah, for sure.
Even if you're doing the stuff.
The work gets intense and more, and once in a while you fall on some, oh my God, some customer that will pull your brains out of your rear end, and he'll really explain you all about life. And it's, you know, I like to think that I'm a nice person when I'm dealing with other people. When I'm asking for someone else for a service, I like to think that I'm not a pain in the rear. But some customers, especially in Israel, they see you. That's the thing. You know what? Let's start over. They don't see you. They like the fish, and they like it toasted. They're not here to – they don't care about the fish. They like it, but they like it toasted. They look at you like an object, and they don't see you as a person. I mean, that reminds me of like the halacha of like a person without kids, or an old man that all his kids are already out the door, shouldn't be a teacher because he has no mercy left in him, or something like that. I'm not sure. Well, there's something like that.
The way I see this – in terms of how people are treated in Israel, it's a reflection of a certain level of poverty. Because if you're making enough money, even if you're just an average guy, clerk at a supermarket, whatever, but if you're making enough money and you make ends meet, then you're not as stressed thinking about all the problems in your life as much, and you can afford to be a real person to other people. And just relax with them.
So
and,
you're saying the
level of taxation,
the chillness in America.
Yeah, yeah. America is getting less chill, but it's much more chill than here. I mean, you initially wanted to talk about Yetzias Mitzrayim, right? So let me bring that in for a second. Like, I point this out a lot, and it's like it inspires just like blank faces because they don't even know what I'm saying. But the highest level of taxation in the Torah that is mentioned leading to slavery is paros, which is chomesh, 20%. 20% income tax. That's it, right? And that's in Parshas Vayigash, right? So after Paro taxes all the Egyptians 20% after Yosef, you know, buys everything for him, they're called avadim lefaro because they pay 20% income tax. That's it. That's slavery. But look what we pay here. It's unbelievable. And the fact that it causes stress among people and people's daily lives here, there's a lot of misery here. But of course, Zionism or whatever you want to call it keeps us together as a family, but there's a lot of pain. A lot of pain.
So you're saying that Jews in their nature can withstand a lot of pain, and the fact that you see them...
We can withstand a lot of slavery too. We're slaves to the state of Israel.
We've been shuffled all over the place, and every nation has had its chance to smack us silly. So we've been through a lot, and I think, you know, this is what upsets me a little bit at the end of the day, that we come finally to Israel, and what do we get? We get a few nut job politicians. We get a unreliable justice system. We get corrupt crony politicians. We get the same BS that we've been running away from for 2,000 years.
It's the same with any monopoly. If anyone has a monopoly over justice, you're not going to have justice. If anyone has a monopoly over schools, you're not going to have education. I don't complain.
You're saying that the Sanhedrin should be busted open, a caliphate should be busted open, and a priesthood should be busted open, so that there should be more competition in justice.
I'm saying privatize the justice system. If you want laws, fine. Yeah. Law, okay, yeah. Fine. But then have, you know, like Sanhedrin, like Masechah Sanhedrin, Zeborechad Shneim Borin.
You have like.
Yeah. Okay.
The justice system of Scientology. Would you like to be?
Very simple. You have an argument. So one side picks one judge. The other side picks another judge. The two of them to come together and pick a third judge, and then they arbitrate.
That would be funny. A Jew and a Christian have an argument. The Jew picks a rabbi. The Christian picks the priest and the rabbi get together. They're like, who should we pick as the third guy? Let's get an imam just to make it that. Yeah.
So you mean I was talking.
That would actually be funny.
I was talking.
What about if an Arab and a Jew get into a fight, and like the imam's like, you should kill him, and the rabbi's like, now you're making me say he should kill him.
That's the kind of Torah, that's the kind of halacha that even chilonim can participate in and have discussions. Okay, look, forget it. Like, everyone's talking about kashrus and Shabbos and all these minutiae details that chilonim don't care about.
You know what I'm thinking of now? The judiciary system of the drag queens. Imagine like some LGBT whatever guy has an issue with somebody else. He brings out this big drag queen. They're like, "Excuse me, miss. Excuse me, shit. Have a seat." No. Excuse me, queen. Queen? Did you just call me queen? I'd like to make some room. The queen would like to. Anyway.
Wouldn't you like to see that? Like. Chilonim.
Right now, the way it works is every government tells the rabbis, the priests, everybody, if you say anything against what we would say, then we're going to put you in a lawsuit. We're going to sue you till your pants are empty. So all the rabbis and all the imams and all these people are basically scared to say anything that might go against the local bully government. So...
Well, they're paid from the same purse.
Who?
You know, state rabbis.
I'm not talking about state rabbis. Like, even in Crown Heights, where the state, I don't think the state pays Rabbi Shvei.
They don't.
So if Rabbi Shvei is recorded saying that a person shouldn't listen to, or giving a verdict that goes against, let's say a lady comes to the rabbi and she says, "Oh, my husband doesn't want to pay child support," and then the rabbi looks through the papers and says, "Well, according to halacha, so and so and so is the case."
Well, rabbis are licensed by the state to do weddings and divorces and that kind of stuff. So, and they have a tax exempt status, so they can't talk about politics and this. But so, in that sense, they are agents of the state. But it's much farther removed than here, when they're actually paid by the state. And like in every shul that comes up, yeah, they ask the government for money and it creates all this sinastinam and all this stuff. But.
Well. I mean, you know, on one hand, I was thinking to myself, like, you know, defense, you told me that defense is a very small fraction of what the money of taxes go to. But there's just, And I think that it's like the world is like, it's like we said last time, it's coming to this pinnacle, to this point where we have to kind of see. I mean, you know what? At the same time, as I'm talking, I'm thinking to myself, you know how many smart people there are making good recommendations for the world, like good. I mean, eventually, you know, these ideas will spread. There's no doubt about it. We see there was the Renaissance, there was the Enlightenment. There were times when just like a fire blaze of information just swept up the world and just completely formed something else. You have like when Napoleon started fighting in his style, all the other European governments started copying. They had no idea what he's up to. They just saw him, you know, kick them straight to the moon. So they just copied what he was doing. I think that good ideas eventually stick, and eventually we will see the fruits of our...
Well, that's why I'm hoping Jews are back here, even though we're a basket case and we're just embarrassing right now. But we're still, you know, the nation that was founded based on the idea of liberty in Yetzias Mitzrayim. That's still who we are. And we were, just like we were forced out of Mitzrayim, we didn't want to go, and, you know, God, you know, dragged us by the ears and by the hair or whatever. We just came out kicking and screaming. It might be the same time, the same thing now. I mean, we'll you know, there's going to be a catastrophe. Jews will be here. We'll try to figure out what to do, not kill each other. And hopefully from there, we can take our place as, you know, the leaders of the philosophical leaders of the world.
We could, yeah, we can broker a lot of deals with countries that don't get along. Also,
I'm
the
not
fact
talking about making money. I'm talking about just spreading the idea of liberty. It has to come from us. I mean, America was inspired from Jewish ideas of freedom.
I didn't say anything about making money. I said we can broker a lot of deals. We can make peace in the world. Well, and by the way, there's nothing wrong with taking money. Especially, look, forget about what your value, what you're getting when you're doing something, right? Think about the other person, right? Let's say America. For Americans, money is everything, right? So if you tell them, we're
a general statement.
No, I mean, the government, and this, you talk about it, you listen to Trump talk for 5 minutes. $50 billion. Millions and millions and billions. I mean, the point is that if you want something to be valuable to the other person, you need to charge him sometimes in order that he should value what you're giving him. Masha chinam shaveh chinam is an expression. You know,
get what you pay for.
You get what you pay for. So if let's say two countries, let's say Hong Kong and China, they are...
They're really one country, or the Chinese are going to kill you.
Yeah. So let's say that the Chinese are like, you know what, this itch is getting really itchy, and we don't... There's no peace in sight. These, you know, we need someone to broker a deal, and we're ready to pay for it. And they can go, let's say, to the Sanhedrin, and they say, we want to put our case here, and each of us is going to put down whatever so-and-so amount of money in order to solve and come to a settlement. And then the Jews get... They take this money, and then they can forget about everything else for a few minutes because now they have the money. They don't have to pay rent. For the next 30 days, they can stay up all night, all day, and just get all the information. What's going on? Who said this? Who said that? What are you saying? And then get these people in. And then, you know, get the whole fire going. And then be like, okay, because we've been all over the world for the last 2,000 years, and we've seen so many angles to the same problem, we can tell you that, you know, we'll get you that perfect shade of gray, you know, that's not black and not white, but everyone's happy. And then everyone comes to some kind of an agreement. And it's not just some lazy agreement. It's something that can last centuries, can save millions of lives, can give peace of mind for a country, for, you know, just sometimes it's about the setup. It's, you know, like chefs know this. You can have the same exact ingredients. If you line them up in a different way, or the technique of how you line them up, could create worlds of a difference in the quality and the style, the taste and everything. And you can take an omelet and you have 20 different chefs. They basically have the same ingredients. They have a little this, a little that, a little salt, a little that. And the way they hustle the omelet, it completely changes the entire experience, the price that someone's willing to pay for it, the taste, you know. And so it's just... Sometimes it's like, that post that's been floating around a little bit. It's like Airbnb, the biggest hotel company that's worth the most money in the world, doesn't own any property. Facebook, the biggest advertising agency that doesn't own any billboards or anything physical. Uber doesn't. It's the biggest taxi company that doesn't own any cars. What do we? What's the lesson you learn?
Well, Uber is in Uber debt, and they're just a basket case of a company.
Yeah, that's okay, but that's because of their own mismanagement and stupidity. I think they're doing.
Their stupidity. It's just the availability of cheap money, which inspires all these ideas, and most of them are not viable.
What do you mean? Uber? Why would Uber? I mean, Uber. I think is going to get to. As long as it's appealing to the customer, eventually it should catch up with the company. It could be it's not being managed very well right now, but it's a good idea.
They have the highest losses, I think, of any company in history.
How could they be losing money?
How could they? I mean, they have to pay their drivers. They have to pay for the app. I don't know what their business model is, but it doesn't work.
Well.
It doesn't. I mean, you have
Well, it should work. Airbnb is doing pretty good.
No, they're not.
No?
No.
Airbnb is not doing good either?
No. They're just able to collect. They're able to issue more debt to keep going because debt is so cheap and interest is so low. But they're not. They're not doing good.
Wow, this is news, ladies and gentlemen. Rafi is completely changing my perspective. But back to my original point. I think that there's this yesh me'ayin concept, you know, and there's what I'm trying to say is that there's sometimes something other than the end product itself. Like you know what? Even take these companies themselves, maybe with better management, you know.
It's not just a question of management, but like the whole idea.
Leadership,
proper. The whole concept doesn't work. I mean, like for example, if you have the taxis, you have a centralized location where they can all, you know, get gas and get their cars fixed and. You know, they have a deal with this. If a taxi fleet has a deal with a company to do repairs on. So one example of why Uber can't work in terms of the actual business of it is that if you have a taxi fleet of 1,000 cars and they all need to be repaired and maintained, then they get a discount from whatever company they're using to fix the cars, and it becomes much more economical, much cheaper. To run the cars, whereas every individual who becomes an Uber driver has to get his car fixed individually, and it costs much more. So it's less efficient.
But Uber relies on people doing, like, let's say you're going to work anyway, why don't you pick someone up on the way or something like that kind of stuff.
Yeah, that would be okay, but it can't sustain the business. I mean, you have these dedicated Uber drivers that are trying to make money.
Right. Well, yeah. Okay. But that reminds me of your brilliant, for me at least, explanation of the bananas in Canada, growing them in a what's it called again? The house,
in a hot house.
Yeah, in a controlled environment, so it will cost more to make the bananas in Canada, Canadian made or America made bananas than if you just do it in the jungles of whatever where it's anyway naturally growing, just shipping and handling. So. Yeah, this is management, and you see, Rafi, I think you would be a very you can be a Yoetzayich, you can be from the Yoetzim or from the Sanhedrin, maybe you're Jewish enough. This is the thing. It's not only you have to have the whole picture in order to actually. So this is what Jews are good for. You see, Rafi, you're proving it again. I know that there are. I'm sure there's many non-Jews that are almost as smart as Rafi. Listen.
Nah, I'm not that smart. Well, you have your Yitros.
Yeah, that also. But the thing is, I think that the Jewish people also, like, we at least we've been teaching ourselves, and I think it's become, like, what you teach becomes part of you if you keep it up, that we're the Kol Yaakov. We put our bets on the way we communicate. That's basically what it means. And Hayadayim de Esav is, they put their bets on Al Charb Chatichye, we live on the sword. So, if you tell someone for 2,000 years that the only way he's going to be successful is by being wise enough and explaining himself properly, and that's going to be more powerful than death itself, and so then what you create, I think even scientifically speaking, forget about spiritually speaking, what you create is a people that are as powerful in their mouth as death itself, I think. And then what you have now after 2,000 years is a people that I think are ready and in a position that they can broker deals and create a very, obviously, good service to the world. And Be'ezrat Hashem will be able to get to a place where the world bugs off of us and allows us to prosper and get into that position. And I'm reminded again when I was in Yeshiva back in the day that the Saudis, the first ever reporters that were allowed into the Saudi castles, mansions, to do a full documentary for like 2-3 hours, you know, with all the princes and go around them in the day-to-day life. And at the dinner table, the Saudi princes are talking all about Israel. The Israelis are very smart. They use the TV for their advantage. And this and this and that. You see, media is not always that bad. You can use it for that. And they're just going through. And everything they say, they don't say America. They don't. The Israelis, the Jews, the Israelis. And not in a racist way. I mean, in Israel, if you say, ah, Rusia, this Russian, everyone gets offended because it's like a racial slur almost, I think. Because they think.
Does racism against Jews offend you? I find it an honor.
An honor, yeah. No, I'm saying here in. Because I think that when you say a Russian to an Israeli, like, ah, Rusia, they think that you're saying they're Russian and not Jewish. That's what I think it's the implication of it.
Maybe. I didn't even realize that. I would just use it as a descriptive term.
Exactly, descriptive term. That's what I'm doing. I don't know the lady's name, Henya, Shmenya. I don't know, whatever, Zlata, Plotka, you know, whatever. I just say the Russian lady, what? Excuse me? Her name is this and that. Okay, whatever, you know. I don't care what her name is. not from a racial place. It's a descriptive term, exactly. The black guy, can you pass me the coke?
Soon it's going to be a crime to talk because it's anything you say is going to be offensive, so everyone's going to have to shut up. The Rambam says in Hilchos Midos, right?
What does he say?
Everyone should be quiet as much as possible.
Just shut up.
Yeah.
You're offending people. People are getting triggered. You know, there was a security guard in Banka Palim in Bnei Brak. I think he's not Jewish, I don't think. But I used to schmooze with him. He's a very smart fellow. And I think, I forgot his name. Kamil. And he told me that if you look at the world, you look at the Russians are in the colder places of the world, and they're just chilled. You look at the Arab countries, and it's boiling hot there, and they're losing their mind. They're killing each other. The Arab Spring, the Arab Summer. He said, I think that it's like you have people that are just cooked. It's like it brings out all their emotions. Imagine you have the sun banging your head. It just drives you nuts. You just start... running around, and like you have these Russians that are like, what, your turn, move. Playing chess, you know. It's like the natural habitat just brings out, these guys are in the intellectual, these guys are the emotional, and just driven by the, you know,
what are we, the paranoid people?
We were just yeah, just running from place to place. Oh shit, it's dangerous here. Grab your kids and your wife and kids. Let's go. Let's go. Just pack it all. They're coming. They're coming. And we have reason to be paranoid. I mean, every place we go, we climb the ladder until they throw us off the top. Oh, man.
Yeah, we got to wrap it up.
All right, Rafi. It's been a pleasure having you. You're always a bomb. I mean, you see, guys, what you don't understand is that me and Rafi talking is complex because we have hundreds of people that live in Katsurin. But how many of them understand that what you say and what gets published online and spreads throughout the world can actually have an effect not only today, but maybe even in 100 or even 1,000 years? How many people today understand that? And how many people have the guts to come and share their wisdom? There are many very smart people. Not all of them understand the power of spreading the word. And we're not claiming that we know everything. But we're on a quest. We're on a journey. We're trying to make a better tomorrow, and in Chassidus and in, you know, especially the Mashiach stuff, it's all about the, like it says that all the mitzvahs v'teilas lasid lava, and then even if we do it, whatever. But the whole question becomes, what's the schar v'onesh going to ever be about, or what's the whole, like, once we're not doing, we're not killing, we're not stealing, we're not doing any problem, we're not making any problems, what's gonna be? It's almost like b'chir chavshus is swept from under your feet, freedom of choice. No, it's going to be about intellectual warfare, and I think that that's what we're seeing now. We're seeing a place of enlightenment. People are more interested in understanding what other people are about and other opinions and this and that. So we're living Mashiach like the Rebbe wants us to. I mean, I am, and Rafi maybe as well. I have to ask him. He's just living, man.
Matthew McConaughey.
All right, we call it a wrap. Guacamole wrap. Yechi HaMelech, like, subscribe, spread the word. Sit down, be humble. Sit down, be humble. Sit down, be humble. Sit down.